eternal life, believe to be alive. Now, as we build on this, I wanted to tell you about something that's kind of going on online right now. As you guys might know, we have a number of social media outlets that we use to talk about the gospel and share with our ministry and stuff like that. And we posted a video that was very similar to what we finished up last week with, the drawing of John 3:16. You might have seen it. And we've gotten about 25,000 views or so on that so far, which is cool, which apparently means people are enjoying watching it. But we're also getting a lot of sort of angry, disagreeable comments on it, which is really normal. It's really normal when you online, when you talk about the gospel, when you talk to people about Jesus. We've found that it's very common for people to feel very free to tell you what they think about it. And there's a lot that disagree. And ultimately, what most of the disagreement comes down to is not atheists or non-believers. It's believers who disagree with the concept that we should be able to share the gospel from the Gospel of John, and specifically from John 3:16. And so I've been having some interesting conversations this week with people trying to explain that, trying to explain why we believe that that's a possibility. And so just the reason why I tell you that is so that you realize this is a very present modern issue. This confusion, this disagreement about what the gospel is, what the saving message includes. And we just simply maintain that John 3:16 is, in essence, what Jesus' saving message is. Now, there's other great verses in the Gospel of John, but that's one of those that is just so great at showing us what the saving message is. Now, the section of the book we're going to talk about today is called The Obligation. And you say, well, obligation, that's kind of a funny word. What are we getting at? Well, let me just kind of lay this out by explaining the kind of obligations that you face on a daily basis. If you and I are standing in front of one another and I hover my hand in the space between you and I, you are socially obligated to shake it. I mean, usually that's what we do. Say, hello, my name is, and we have a social obligation. You reach out and shake it. Now, if you forego that, if you say, I don't shake hands, which I know a guy that says, I don't shake hands, it's a little awkward, but he survives. It's no big deal. It's a social obligation, but we can overlook it. You have other social obligations, like when you're driving and somebody puts their blinker on, your social obligation is to let them into your lane, right? But you guys know you've not followed that one sometimes, right? And you survive. I mean, as long as he doesn't come over anyway. Anyways, you'll survive. So we have social obligations, and we understand that. There's social obligations that we can overlook, that we can step aside, and that's okay. However, there are other kinds of obligations that we have that are much more important. And I would call these life-giving obligations. For instance, you need to breathe air. And if you go this entire service without taking a breath, well, you're probably not going to make it. So that is a life-giving obligation. You need to be breathing on a regular basis. You need to be eating food. If you don't eat food, that's usually not the problem for me. I tend to eat a little too much, but you get the idea. It's a life-giving obligation we need to be doing. We need to be drinking water. We need to sleep. There's certain life-giving obligations that we must abide by, or our life will end prematurely. Do you know that there's actually an obligation for spiritual life? And it's an obligation that Jesus talks about a bunch in the Gospel of John. And it's in other books of the Bible, of course, but it's often in the Gospel of John. And so the chapters in this section of the book that we're talking about are the obligation, which is believe in, and then convinced in Greek. Now, we're not going to do a big Greek lesson today. I'm not all that great in Greek, but we're not going to do a big Greek thing, but I wanted to mention a couple of things. We'll look at that in a few minutes. And then we're going to spend most of our time today talking about what the word believe means in the New Testament, what it means in the Bible. So, I want to remind you of what the purpose of the Gospel of John is. Now, you probably remember this because we've talked about it multiple times, especially last week. But we looked at John 20, 30, and 31. And what that tells us is that the purpose of the Gospel of John is to tell its readers how to have eternal life. If you want salvation, which is what we call it sometimes, it's in the Gospel of John. I mean, that's what John says his purpose is. And that's really important that we remember that, because if you are going to share the gospel, my premise is we should be opening up to the Gospel of John. That should be the place that we go. It's very, very important to remember that. And so what I want to do in the next minute or so is I want to read somewhat rapidly about eight different verses from the Gospel of John where we can see the consistent message that Jesus and a couple of his followers taught throughout the Gospel of John. So I'm just going to read these. We're going to look closer at them in future weeks, but I'm just going to read through them because you're going to notice the message that John is presenting. So here we go. These are the verses that we're going to look at quickly. Everyone who believes in him will have eternal life, John 3:15. Everyone who believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life, John 3:16. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, John 3:36. Whoever hears my word and believes has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life, John 5:24. Everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, John 6:40. The one who believes has eternal life, John 6:47. The one who believes in me will live even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die, John 11:25 through 26. And finally, by believing you may have life in his name, John 20, 30 and 31, specifically 31. So you begin to see this pattern. Right? There is a word that is in every single one of those. And those are what I call John's salvation statements. Those are the statements that John and Jesus and John the Baptist had spoke in the Gospel of John that tell us how to have eternal life. And the one thing that we see over and over, not the one thing, but one of the things that we see over and over is what I would call the obligation. So I want to show you this chart. I know it's a little bit small, but this chart is broken into three main aspects. And these are the three aspects that I teach that are the three parts of what you must do to have salvation. And we're going to look at the object and the objective in future weeks, but this week we're looking at the obligation. So every statement in the Gospel of John that tells someone how to have eternal life has an obligation, it has an object, and it has an objective. And we'll look at the next two in the next few weeks. But in this chart, what you'll notice is that when you lay them out, when you put them next to each other, they are all very, very similar. I mean, Jesus said this over and over and over. And in fact, there's more verses than these in the Gospel of John, but these are the ones that fit on the chart on one screen. So they're very, very similar. And we see the word believe in every single one of them. So what that tells us is that our life-giving obligation is to believe. If you want eternal life, you need to believe. Now, here is the difficulty. There are a lot of people that have a lot of different definitions of the word believe. And that's what we're going to wrestle with today, is what does it mean to believe? There are lots of different conflicting definitions for the word believe, and we need to sort them out. And so that's what we're going to spend most of our time today talking about. So the obligation is to believe in. Now, I had a chapter in the book that I ultimately took out because I thought it would bore people, but some people will argue that believe in is different than believe that, or just the word believe. And in my research, there's no real difference. Believe in is the same thing as believe or believe that. It just is a different way of looking at it. So in the Gospel of John, sometimes it says that when people have eternal life, they believe in. And when it says it that way, it's believe in Jesus. Sometimes it says believe that. When it says it that way, it says believe that he's the Christ, the Son of God. And sometimes it just says they believe, which implies those other things. So these are all the same. But the most common one, the one we see a little more than 30, maybe it's 35 or 36 times, is believe in. That we need to believe in Jesus. And so the question today is, what does that mean? What does it mean to believe, and specifically to believe in Jesus? Now, this is my kind of chart. You guys know I like charts and I like to doodle. And so I have these three aspects, the obligation, the object, and the objective. Now, in future weeks, we're going to look at the other two that are not filled out, but today's is believe, and that is the obligation. Now, this chart, I know you can't read it. It's in the book, but I didn't really put this up here so that you could scour it. What this is a chart of how the word believe was used in ancient Greek, because you may be wondering, how was the word believe used in ancient Greek? But that also is probably something you haven't wondered. And if you're not like me, then maybe you've never wondered that. that. But for a long time, I did. And the reason why I did is because it is the kind of the crux of the what we'll call the free grace argument. I mean, if you're making a free grace pitch that salvation is free apart from works, ultimately, it all comes down to how do you define believe. And so I had wondered for a long time, I wonder how the ancient secular writers that wrote Greek used the word believe. And I wondered that for years. All the time, I had this book on my shelf that some old pastor who had retired gave me. And it was, see if I can remember, it's something like semantic domain and Greek etymology in the ancient world or something like that. And I'd never opened it. I just thought, that's why would I ever, I don't know. But I began to have this question. I wonder what it meant for like Homer and these other writers in Greek. And do you know that all of that information was actually in that book that sat on my shelf for like 8 years? Not long ago, I opened it and I found basically what you see here. And so what I want to do is just kind of read some of these so that you can kind of see how it was used by Greek writers. I'll make this quick, but having to do with trust was how Homer used it. A guy named Theognis used it being convinced that a specific person was trustworthy. Another used certainty. Another, confidence in a statement or a person's trustworthiness. The reliability of a person, being convinced a person had spoken the truth. Certainty, to consider something to be true, to be convinced of something, or certainty. So this is how the word was used before Jesus showed up on the scene. Now, a lot of people kind of have this idea that when the apostles began to write the New Testament, they redefined the word. We don't have any evidence that that's true. As far as we can tell, they just used the word in the exact same way that it was used in the language of the time. If they were redefining the word, it would be the responsible thing to tell us that. But what we have is that they used it in the same way that the writers of the time used it. Now, if you want to dig deeper into that, you can. It's in the book and there's footnotes and stuff like that. That's about all I want to say on that. Just the bottom line on that is that we have no reason to think that the word suddenly started meaning something new when the apostles began to write. So here's the big question, and this is what we're going to spend most of our time today on, is what does it mean in the New Testament? What does the word believe mean in the Bible? There's basically two words that have to do with belief that show up a bunch, and these are the ones that are used in the Gospel of John. In Greek, it's pistuo, and there's variations on that, and pistis, which one is the verb, one is the noun. Now, again, we're not going to go into Greek, but those are basically the words that we're trying to figure out. What did those mean to the apostles, to the ones who were writing down the New Testament? So what I want to do is just break this quickly into the different writers of the New Testament and look at how they used the word. And so the first one we're going to look at is Paul. So Paul used the word believe and faith quite often, believe, belief, and faith quite often. So let's take a look at some of the things he said. This is in Romans chapter 4, and he's talking about Abraham here, okay? So he's talking about the faith that Abraham had. It says, he did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief. So basically what he's saying is God had a promise. He was giving that promise to Abraham, and Abraham didn't waver in unbelief, which ultimately meant Abraham believed. Abraham believed the promise. So he did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, being fully convinced that what he had promised, he was also able to perform. And therefore, it was accounted to him for righteousness, but also it shall be imputed to us who believe. Now, what I want to do is just kind of highlight a couple of phrases here. The first is accounted to him as righteousness. That's not something we would say real often, like in modern, like I can't think of the last time I said, hey, my son is accounted for righteousness. So we probably need to think about that phrase a little bit. What does it mean? So accounted for righteousness, another word that we use for this sometimes that Paul used was justification. Justification ultimately means to be declared righteous or accounted righteous. So these are the same things. Now, if you read through Paul's writing, what you discover is that when he talks about justification, he's talking about this. He's talking about those who are eternally saved, those who have been given the gift of eternal life. So if you've been given the gift of eternal life, whether you knew the word or not, you've been justified. You've been accounted righteous before God. So, accounted righteous, justification, it has to do with eternal salvation. Now, notice this last word. He says, but also it shall be imputed to us who believe. Okay, so we're talking about beliefs. We're talking about people even today. And so we were just taking a look at the fact that Abraham was accounted righteous for his belief. And now this is saying, and by the way, this can happen for you too, for those who believe. So ultimately what we see is eternal salvation by belief. What you believe determines where you will spend eternity. How you get into heaven is based on what you believe. That's what Paul is saying. And a lot of people kind of get a little bit confused and think that Paul is saying different things than John was saying in the Gospel of John. But right there we have it. Paul is talking about your faith or your belief, which are the same word. That is what determines your justification and ultimately your eternal salvation. So we're talking about the belief that got Abraham saved. Now let's go back to the first couple of phrases that he uses, because we're going to see a synonym for faith and belief that Paul uses. So let's read it again. He did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith. Now I want to highlight these two words, belief and faith. I was sitting with a friend the other day at our kitchen table. And I may have told you this, but I think it's worth repeating. And I asked him, do you think there's a difference between faith and belief? And he said, yeah. Yeah, there does seem to be a difference. And I said, okay, well, what's the difference? I mean, give me a definition of those two. And this is a guy that grew up in church. He knows church terminology pretty well. He speaks Christianese. But he said, yeah, I don't know. I don't know what the difference is on those. They do seem like they're different. They seem like different words. They seem like they mean something a little bit different, but I'm not exactly sure what it is. And so what I want to do for you real quickly is to define for us how faith and belief fit together. So you know the word believe. That's pistuo in Greek, and it's a verb. So I could tell you to believe. It's not something you have, it's something you do, so to speak. So that's a verb. So the noun form of believe is belief. So belief is something you have, not something you do. Now, they're very interconnected, of course, because if you believe, then you have belief. If you have belief, that means you've believed. Okay, so those are interconnected, obviously. But there's another synonym for belief that you may not realize that comes from the exact same Greek word, and it's faith. So faith is the noun form of the word believe. Believe is the verb, faith is the noun. Now here's why this happens. I mean, because you may say, well, why don't they just always use the word belief when they translate it? Well, it's because we don't have a verb form of the word faith in English. I can't say, Dale, faith me. I'm going to tell you the truth, faith me. That's a weird English, it doesn't work in English. So what I have to say is, believe me, Dale, I'm going to tell you the truth. And then if you believe me, then I could say, well, you have faith that what I said was true. Or I could say, you have belief that what I've said was true. So those are synonyms. In Greek, they are not different. They're the same word. And so when you see the word faith in your New Testament, it is a synonym for belief. So I said I wouldn't do Greek stuff, so we'll move on from that. But you get the idea. Now, the reason why I tell you that is because we see the word unbelief and faith. Now, here's the interesting thing in this. In Greek, these two words are almost the same, except one has the un, which in Greek is the a. It's a pistuai, and then when it says faith, it says pistis. So there, what we have is the translators chose two different words. They said unbelief on one, because we don't use the word unfaith, really. So they use unbelief, but then when they came to the word pistis, they used faith. And so we just got to recognize those are the same. Now, here's why I'm telling you all this. You're thinking, what in the world does that matter? Because Paul then gives us a synonym for both belief and faith. And here it is. He says, being fully convinced that what he had promised, he was also able to perform. Okay, do you see it? So Paul is talking about belief and faith, and then he gives us this synonym, being fully convinced that what he had promised, he was also able to perform. The he in the sentence that's capitalized is God. So God gave Abraham a promise. Abraham believed that it was true, which means he was fully convinced that it was going to happen. And that's what he means when he says faith and belief. So we could sort of simplify this, and we could call it being fully convinced that God can do what he promised. If we took it out of the context, we might could just say simply belief and faith are being fully convinced. Now let's test drive this in like the natural world. So if I said to you, do you believe that the sky is blue? And you said yes. What have you just done based on this definition? You're fully convinced. Right? That's how we use the word. We use it in the natural world that way all the time. It's very, very common. Do you believe that the ocean is deep? Even though you haven't been to the bottom of the ocean, you believe that the ocean is deep. This is the word that we're using here. It means that you're convinced that that statement is true. And so that's how Paul used it there. So, in that verse at least, Paul is using the word belief and faith as a synonym for being fully convinced. Now, you may wonder, how does Luke use it? Luke wrote a large section of the New Testament. He wrote the Gospel of Luke, and he also wrote Acts. And so he had a very important role to play in getting the message of the New Testament out. So how does Luke use the word? Well, Luke has a very similar kind of approach to the word. So this is in Acts, and at this point, Luke is going through one of the missionary journeys that he did with Paul. And he's kind of fallen into this rhythm where he said, we went here and this is what happened. Then we went here and this is what happened. Then we went here and this is what happened. And so that's basically the place where he is. So notice what he says here. In Berea, many of them believed, and also not a few of the Greeks, prominent women, as well as the men. But then in the same chapter, he says this. In Thessalonica, some of them were persuaded, and a great multitude of the devout Greeks and not a few of the leading women joined Paul and Silas. Now, I know that may just be like word soup, like what does that matter? You notice those two phrases he just used were very similar, except there's one little difference. In Thessalonica, some of them were persuaded. In Berea, many of them believed. So what we see in this is that Luke is using this as a synonym. When he uses the word believe, he's using it as a synonym for were persuaded, which is very similar to were convinced. In fact, you'll find some translations that probably use the word convinced there. And so believe, for Luke, it seems, means to be persuaded, or that someone is or was persuaded. Luke has another one that's really simple. Some of them were convinced by what he said, but others refused to believe. I mean, that's pretty straightforward, right? I mean, some were convinced. Does he use convinced or persuaded? Yeah. Some were convinced, and then on the other hand, some refused to believe. So if you refuse to believe, and that's the opposite of being convinced, then convinced would have to mean believe. Those have to be synonyms. This is what we see in Luke's writing. So Luke, like Paul, uses the same concept. Paul's word was fully convinced. Luke's is convinced or persuaded. So we see a consistency there. So believe there for Luke means were convinced. So you might wonder how John uses it, because you're saying, well, this is sort of a circuitous route. We're really talking about the Gospel of John. How is it used in the Gospel of John? Well, first of all, if the word is used differently in the Gospel of John than it is in the rest of the Bible, John should tell us. I mean, John should have like a little disclaimer at the beginning that says, you know, I'm going to use the word differently. But he doesn't have that, by the way. I mean, he uses it the way that his readers would expect. And he wrote, like the rest of the New Testament, in a very common form of Greek. He wrote in Koine, which is just the common language of the time. So he was not inventing some new academic approach. He was talking on a level that average people could understand. You might know this, but our newspapers generally are written on a 6th to 8th grade reading level. I think that's what John was doing. He was writing in a simple way. He was not reinventing words or changing words. He was using it in the same way. And so we could probably stop right here and say, well, if Paul used it that way and Luke used it that way, then that's what it means. But let's see how John uses the word. Even as he spoke, many believed in him. Okay, so here's our difficulty that a lot of people have been sort of taken in by. There are those out there that will say you haven't really believed unless your life changes. Or you haven't really believed unless you add works to it. Or you haven't really believed unless there's some external evidence. But notice what John just said here. This scene is in John chapter 8, and Jesus is giving a talk. Okay, and there's people in the audience. And while he's talking, it tells us that they believed in him. And John is confident about this. I mean, John says it very simply that they believed in him. And then what's interesting is then Jesus follows it by saying, basically, I hope you'll abide with me. But he's implying that some of you probably won't. You've believed, but some of you probably won't remain. You won't abide. And he says, you will be my true disciples if you stay or if you remain or if you abide. And what he's basically saying here is that's separate from this moment where they believe. So notice what happens here. Nobody walks an aisle. Nobody fills out a card. Nobody prays a prayer. They're just in the audience and something clicks internally. And John somehow knows that, probably because Jesus told him later or he recognized it. But it's internal. It's something that didn't even have any external evidence because they are just standing there in the audience. So, if that were the only evidence we had from John, we may still have the jury out, but John has some others that are interesting. Jesus said to him, this is in John 4, by the way. Jesus said to him, "Go your way, your son lives." So the man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him. Now, this is a really natural use of the word believe, right? I mean, if I said something to you, you could either believe me or not. And we would understand that that means you are either convinced that I'm telling the truth or you're not convinced that I'm telling the truth. So imagine that I said, I've heard this example before from some friends. Imagine I said, "Do you believe that Donald Trump is our president?" Don't worry, this is not going to be political. But let me say, if I asked you, "Do you believe that Donald Trump is our president?" You said, "Yes, I believe that's true." And then I said, well, you're not living like it." That wouldn't make any sense. I mean, your actions don't have anything to do necessarily with your belief. Now, you could add actions to that belief and go to rallies or be very political, or you could be completely apolitical. You could stay out of the political debate altogether. That does not mean you don't believe that Donald Trump is our president. That's a part. So belief is a part from actions. Notice how John puts it here. So the man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him. That's very, very natural. We understand what he's saying. He believed that what Jesus had just said about his son was true. Very simple. So the man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him. Now, what I want to do is kind of test drive some of the synonyms that we've seen already. Okay, so let's just remove the word believe. By the way, I'm not editing the Bible. This is just for experiment's sake. Okay, so we'll put believe back in at the end. But let's just kind of test drive some of the synonyms we found that Paul used and that Luke used. So what if we dropped in this synonym? So the man was convinced the word that Jesus spoke to him was true. Would that work in that sentence? Absolutely, that's a great sentence. In fact, it seems to me that it means the exact same thing that what believe means. We could say the same with persuaded. So the man was persuaded the word that Jesus spoke to him was true. This would be a very, very natural reading of this. Okay, so it matters to us that this works in this verse. Now, some would look at that and say, well, yeah, it works in that verse, but there's other verses where John means something else. And I'd say, well, how do we know that? Has he told us that? Does he have a disclaimer somewhere that he's going to use the word differently when he's talking about spiritual aspects? And I would say no. And in fact, we have evidence that that is not the case in the verse that we're going to see that Jesus speaks in just a second. So John used the word in a way that fits exactly with the way that Paul and Luke used the word. Now we get to the biggie. How did Jesus use the word? We have lots of quotes in red letters from Jesus. How did Jesus use the word believe? Notice this. He's speaking to Nicodemus. This is John chapter 3. He says, "I have spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak to you of heavenly things?" This is such a fundamental verse, because what he's telling us is that the kind of belief that we use for natural things, things that happen in the world, is the same essence. It's the same kind of belief that we use for heavenly things. I mean, what Jesus was just talking to him about was the wind. He was talking to him about kids being born, and he was adding to that some spiritual aspects. But then he says to Nicodemus in this interaction, he says, "You are the teacher of Israel, and you don't know this stuff?" And then he says this, "I've spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe." So ultimately, what he's saying is that you use belief every day. If I say, "Is the sky blue? Is the ocean deep? Is the grass green?" You could say, "Yeah, I believe that." You use belief on a regular basis. And then he says, but how will you then believe if I speak of heavenly things? The difference is not that you'll use a different essence of belief, that it's somehow foreign or somehow different. Belief is still what you'd use. It's just the subject is different. I talked about earthly things. I'm going to talk about heavenly things. And that belief would be the same, even though the subject or the topic is different. So you use belief for heavenly topics in the same way that you use belief for natural topics. And my favorite example of this is the one I already said. Do you believe that the ocean is deep? Has anybody ever been to the bottom of the Marianas Trench? I know you haven't, because nobody has. Nobody has been down there except maybe one guy in like a metal cage of some kind. I don't know. So nobody's really been down there, but we've done sounding tests and we are very confident. And in fact, I would say we believe that it's, 7 miles or something? It's crazy, crazy deep, and nobody's seen it. So we believe that it's true. That's a belief about an earthly thing. Do you believe that heaven exists? You'd say, yeah. I mean, I think we would all say, yeah. Do you believe that heaven exists? Have any of you been there? No, I don't think any of you have been there. As far as I know, you haven't been there. It's the same essence. We believe that the ocean is deep, and we believe that heaven is there. It's not a different kind of belief. It's not a different kind of faith. It's the same thing. Okay, I've been beating the dead horse. Let's move on. You get the idea. But since you do not believe that what he wrote, how are you going to believe what I say? This is Jesus talking to the Pharisees. He's talking about what they believe about Moses' writings. And this is a very natural use too, right? I mean, we know what he's saying in this verse. We wouldn't have any need to kind of twist this into some other meaning. He says, basically, you don't believe what Moses wrote. And he's talking specifically about what Moses wrote about him, Jesus. He says, you don't believe what Moses wrote. So how are you going to believe what I say? Once again, we see that same concept. That the belief that they would use about what they read, words that they see in a book, is the same kind of belief that they would use to believe if he is told the truth, if what he says is true. So ultimately what we're seeing here is that when Jesus uses the word, what he means by it is, I want you to be convinced that what I'm telling you is true. He's not saying that you have to have good works to show that you've believed. He's not saying that you have to have life change to prove that you believe, at least not in this context. It's not what he's talking about. He's talking about, do you believe that the content is true? Let's look at one more. This is him talking to the woman at the well. And at this point in the conversation, he is moving her towards understanding that he's a prophet. And so it's very important that she believes the words that he says, that she becomes convinced that he's telling the truth. And in fact, that's his goal at this point. He says, woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. Now, this is something she could not test in that moment. He's asking her to believe him that there was going to come a time soon that everything was going to change. That there was not going to be this bickering between the Samaritans and the Jews about where the temple should be, whether it should be on Mount Gerizim or should it be on Mount Moriah. None of that's going to matter soon because everything's going to change. And what he's doing is he's not saying, I need you to have good works or I need you to repent of sin. He's saying, what I want you to do is believe that I'm telling you the truth. I want you to look forward to this time. And so ultimately what he's doing is the same thing that we've seen already. Be fully convinced that my words are true. Now here's the difficulty. And I'm sure you've probably run into this. Even if you haven't heard somebody say it really directly, you probably run into this. Some people say that believe means something else or that it includes something else. I had a professor in college who I loved this professor. He was brilliant and he was a fantastic guy. But when we got to the Gospel of John, he said, when you see the word believe in the Gospel of John, you need to understand that it means repent of your sins, or at least it includes that. Now, here's why he said that. Because he noticed, like I said, brilliant guy, he noticed the purpose of the Gospel of John was to tell people how to have eternal life. And he noticed that the word repent does not appear in the Gospel of John. So he surmised that that must mean that it implies repentance. Because in his head, salvation had to include repentance of sins. And so that's what he taught his students. And that's what I heard. And even then I thought, boy, John really messed up, didn't he? Because if John didn't use that word, and he's talking about something so important as how you're going to get into heaven. Boy, John the apostle really messed up. I mean, he should have told us that, right? So here's what some say. The believe includes repent of sins. Now, most people will say that doesn't just mean that, but it means that it includes that. Others will say that it means to commit to obey, that you have to intend to change your actions and your life. And then some will say just flat out, it means that you have to change your behavior. That you have not believed unless you change your behavior. And there's kind of some clever acrobatics about how this is done. They might say that, well, you can believe in a moment, but later it'll prove that you didn't really believe if your actions weren't changed then. Or if you don't have good works later on down the line, it'll prove you never really believed. And so ultimately what that means is believe is not a word that can happen for them in one moment. It's something that can only be proven on a very long time scale. And so that is very different from what we see Jesus using the word as. Let's kind of test drive some of these possible definitions, okay? We'll call these the traditional view. It's sort of a traditional view to hold to some of these. So think about what Jesus had said to Nicodemus. And what I want to do is replace the word believe. Again, not editing the Bible. In fact, we probably won't like this new translation we're about to create. But let's just test drive some of these possible synonyms that we were just looking at. So I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not make a commitment. Now that doesn't make any sense based on what he was just talking about. He said, I told you natural things. I talked to you about the wind. I talked to you about birth. I talked to you about all these natural things, and you didn't believe. But if what these people are saying is right, that it must include making a commitment, then what Jesus just said became very befuddling. It becomes very, very confusing. And so the natural definition of the word is the easiest to go with. There's another instance of belief here, right there. So let's put a different one in there. How then will you behave if I speak of heavenly things? Is that what he's talking about? I mean, was Nicodemus's problem that he had bad behavior? Not as far as we know. In fact, Nicodemus was doing a very honorable thing. Nicodemus had come to Jesus to learn from Jesus, even though it could cost him a lot. I don't think that Nicodemus's problem right here was that he was having an issue with bad behavior. Now, he was a sinner who needed to be saved, no doubt about it. But at this moment, Jesus is not talking about his behavior as far as we can tell. He's talking about the fact that he needs to become convinced that Jesus's words are true. Now, here's another one. Remember Jesus talking to the woman at the well? He says to her, believe. I want you to believe what I'm telling you. So let's just kind of replace this with one of those possible synonyms. Woman, repent of your sins. The hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. Okay, now, grammatically that could work, but thematically, I mean, what Jesus is talking about, this suddenly takes the entire discussion in a brand new direction. Because think about what the woman was tied up in. She had some real sins that probably needed to be dealt with and probably pretty soon. But that's not what Jesus was talking about at this point. What Jesus was talking about was not about repenting of her sins. And in fact, what you'll notice if you read that passage, Jesus does not tell her to repent. He doesn't go there. In fact, he sort of moves past her sin. He acknowledges it, but then he moves past it without even really discussing what she needed to do about it. What this would do, if believe means repent of your sins, or if it includes that, it totally skews the entire message of what Jesus is trying to get across. So, I think the easiest way to approach this is to simply say that Jesus used the word the same way that the apostles did. I mean, where did they learn it? They had to have learned it from Jesus. So when Jesus uses the word believe, he meant the same thing that the ancient secular writers meant when they used the word, except he was talking about heavenly subjects. When the apostles used the word, they meant the word the same way that Jesus meant it. And so when we put this all together, it becomes really quite clear. I think the word, this is a long pitch to get to this, but the word ultimately means to be convinced or to be persuaded, to believe that something is true. And those that add to it works, it's just confused. Because we do hope that when someone believes in Jesus that their life will change. We hope that. But it is not proof that they never believed if their life doesn't change. That is a separate following issue that comes later that needs to be dealt with. So, I want to illustrate all this, I think, in a simple way, because we talked about a bunch of stuff that maybe leaves your brain feeling tied up. I want to make this really simple. So this is our guy, right? This could be an anybody. And he comes in contact with what we'll call a truth claim. Now, this truth claim could be the grass is green, right? Could be the sky is blue. It could be the ocean is made of water. Or it could be more heavenly type things like Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is the Christ. Jesus came to earth, died for your sins, rose from the dead. It could be any of that. Okay, but it's a truth claim. And truth claims, the way I like to look at it is a basic truth claim can be boiled down to a true or false. Okay, so it's not a basic claim if it can't be said true or false. So if I'm presenting a truth claim, then what I'm basically saying is it true or is it false? It's a statement like that. And here's what it means to believe. You check true in your head. Now, you may not have boxes in your head, but you get the idea. You consider it true or false. It's as simple as that. That's what I see in Scripture. Now, I know that there are people that teach it differently. I know that there are people that take it and say it's got to mean something else, but they're not taking that from the actual definition of the word. They're taking it from extrapolation, from a lot of different directions. So for me, this is the simplest. This is the easiest. And I'm gonna tell you what I think some great synonyms are. And once again, I know there are people that teach it very differently than this, but these are synonyms that I think work quite well. To be persuaded. I can hardly see my screen back there, so I'll say it here. Be persuaded. to cognitively accept, to intellectually assent, to consider trustworthy, to be convinced, to mentally agree, to internally acquiesce, or to consider truthful. Now, if you think back to that first set of verses we looked at, what did Abraham do in that moment when he was considered, when he was accounted righteous? It was as simple as this. He believed that the promise that God gave was true. He just believed it was true. He just believed that the things that God said to him were accurate, that they were going to happen. And that gave him justification in that moment. So, what I want to wrap up with, just because I want to keep reiterating it, is I want to wrap up with our John 3:16 drawing one more time. I'm going to do it a little faster today, but we did it last week, but I want it to kind of get into us to where we can become confident in using this if you feel comfortable using it. So, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. So, the first thing that I like to do is write down the phrase, God so loved the world. And we want to emphasize the word world. And to do that, I like to draw a circle. So this circle represents the world. You may have heard that the earth is round. Well, there it is. So this is the world. Now, in the verse, you'll notice the word whoever. And the world is filled with whoever's. You're a whoever, I'm a whoever, we're all whoever's. And so the world is filled with whoever's. But there's a problem. And the problem is that these whoevers are facing a real mess. The world is in a mess, and you know it, and we see the effects of it, but ultimately it comes down to this. The world and its whoevers are going to perish. That word is right there in the verse. And in fact, we see the word perish, and we also see the word eternal. So this verse lets us know that we're talking about an eternal state of affairs. Each of us is going to perish. And if we perish, and we don't do what this verse tells us to, then that perishing is going to last forever. We are going to be in a state of perishing forever and ever and ever. So this is the situation. But you know what? It's a good thing that God so loved the world. He decided to do something about this big mess. And it's this. He gave his only Son. So I like to write the word God's Son in the world, because what God did when he gave his Son, it was not some distant thing. He sent his Son to the world. To do what? Well, he came, he lived an amazing life, he did miracles, he taught, and ultimately he died on the cross for our sins. He died in our place and took away, as John the Baptist put it, he took away the sins of the world. He dealt with our sin problem. So now all we need to do is what the verse tells us. So Jesus came to the world and died this death, and then ultimately he raised back from the dead. And that's the best proof that he can actually deliver on this promise. And the verse goes on to tell us that whoever believes in him, and specifically we're talking about God's Son. Jesus spoke these words, so that's who he's talking about. Whoever believes in Jesus, in the way that this verse talks about, will, we have a problem. They're not going to perish, because the verse says not. They will not perish. What an amazing thing. So suddenly our destiny has changed when we've believed in Jesus. This happens in a moment. This can't be a long-term process. This has to happen in that moment, because it's about believing. You may say, well, what does believing mean? We talked about it a bunch today, but ultimately it means that you are convinced that what this verse says is true, that Jesus and God promise you the free gift of eternal life. And like Abraham, if you are convinced that it's true, if you believe in Jesus for that free gift, then you have it in a moment, as soon as you believe it. And ultimately, the verse tells us this, finally, that whoever believes in him, in God's Son, will not perish, but have eternal life. It's an amazing promise. And when we understand how simple it is to believe, it's even more amazing. Because it does not tell us that we need to do good works. It does not tell us that someday we may realize that we never really did it in the first place. He's offering this as an absolute promise. And the question is, have you believed it? Have you believed this? Have you believed that it's a free gift that you can't lose, that you gain the moment you believe in him? I think probably most of us have, but it's an amazing, amazing promise. Let's pray.